friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear.
First Kings, Second Kings, and even some of what's in Samuel. There's additional information in Chronicles, and Chronicles sometimes will give more information. In fact, there's another story about King Asa that you find over in Chronicles that's really not in our reading today. Do you know what story that would be? It has to do with basically Ethiopia, Somalia, Sudan, that area. That was the land of Cush, the Cushites. They were a real threat, and they went to war against Asa in Judah. And Asa sought the Lord. The Cushites, they had over a million people. They had a million men in their army. Asa only had, I think, 500,000, so they were outnumbered 2-1. But it says in that passage of Scripture that Asa did seek the Lord, and the Lord delivered the Cushites by massive victory into their hands. So, you know, and I think that the lesson, to their credit, they do mention these events. They maybe don't go into a lot of detail, but I think it was kind of mentioned in the lesson. But one of the bad things about going through just one account, when you've got two accounts, it would be like us studying one gospel and maybe not studying the other three, because there may be other stuff in the other three gospels that's not in the one that you're studying. So, but as I said, to their credit, they do kind of mention this. Today's lesson is entitled what?
Return.
What does it have to do with? What does it have to do with? And it's speaking specifically about Asa, who lived thousands of years ago. But it is speaking, I feel like, to us today. And that, I think, will be the real value of today's lesson. There might be various things that you could take away from today's lesson, but we may have to ask ourselves the question, in what ways is it even valid to ask this question? In what ways have we maybe drifted away from the Lord? Are we drifting away from the Lord? And I'm talking about us personally. Do we see elements in our life? I'll be the first to speak up, and I know that the main reason why we've not done our Sunday night and Wednesday night services was so that I could care for my dad and care for my mom. Very grateful for that. But there's a concern. There's a concern. And I know that most people, actually, it's been rather humbling to me. And I'm not saying this to feel sorry for myself or to shame anybody else. But I made comment to people. It's been an eye-opener, because I feel like that most churches are like Calvary Baptist Church. All they want is a Sunday morning service. They'll take Sunday school, Sunday morning service. And you look around throughout our county. Most churches that used to do a Sunday night service, Wednesday night service, don't do it anymore.
And the whole media is leading us away from the Lord. Just with what we hear on the news, the music that we hear, movie theaters are filled with the garbage. Just it floods our minds, and it's hard to focus on the Lord, especially if you're not reading the Bible.
I read a story, I can't remember if it was yesterday or this morning, out in, I think it was Seattle, a street preacher arrested. He was reading from the Gospel of Matthew in public. There was an abortion rally nearby, and I don't know, it didn't say how far away it was. Ten police came and arrested him for reading the Bible. So when you talk about the influence of media and everything else, you and I have seen the protest of, I don't care if it's Antifa, Black Lives Matter, or you name it, the abortion people that are targeting people in the Supreme Court, which is a direct violation of the law. I mean,
where's freedom of religion? Freedom of speech.
Merrick Garland, who is the Attorney General, refuses to prosecute or to protect. So there are those influences. But I'll say this much, Dave. I think the biggest thing is ourselves. Do we lose sight of where we once were and where we're headed? And quite honestly, Asa had to bring about reforms because, and we dealt with this, I think it was 2 weeks ago with Solomon, because he married so many foreign women, 700 wives, 300 concubines, and it said specifically that they turned his heart away from the Lord, but he began to drift. You know, when he first started out, he had a sacrifice of 1,000 animals. The Lord got down on his hands and knees, spread his arms out toward heaven, made a big show of it. There was this level of devotion within his life, but then when you reach the end of his life, he has totally drifted away from where he once was. And I look at the church of today, and I see the same thing happening.
It's our lifestyle.
Well, it's our lifestyle, but again, I think that it calls for Christians to really analyze studies like today and ask, am I drifting? And you could take it on a personal level, you could take it on a church level. Is our church drifting? Are our churches throughout the county, are they drifting? I know that many of y'all don't know Joe Morris. I think I've told you this. Joe and Penny Morris, they came to our church. You know him? Well, Joe and Penny, they came to this church for a long time, and then I guess they felt led elsewhere. They go out to West Liberty now, and Christian church out there. But many times, Joe would come here on Sunday nights, because their church didn't do services. And then when we stopped having services, I talked to him on the phone. He says, do you know of any churches around that even do a Sunday night service anymore? And granted, it's not anywhere in the Bible. I'm just asking us the question, is there taking place within our lives, in our society, the same sort of drifting away that took place during the time of Solomon, and then Solomon's son Rehoboam, and then Abijah, and then you've got, who we're going to talk about, Asa today, that you wake up one morning and you realize, boy, I'm not as close to the Lord as what I used to be. And I'll say without any hesitation, I don't think that we are anywhere near as close to the Lord. Years ago, I'm talking probably 10 years or so ago, I went to visit my sister down in Lexington, Kentucky. I may have told you this. That's the Bible Belt. When you go down into Kentucky, strong Baptist, strong Christian influence everywhere down there. And Sunday night came along, their church, which is a large church, did not have Sunday night service. So I started going through the phone book, trying to find churches, even in Lexington, Kentucky, that would do a Sunday evening service. It was kind of I did find one. It was I hate to mention the name of it, but it was a Baptist church, and I went to that church on a Sunday night, and I just had like a polo shirt like you and Clyde Adam, looked nice, went there. But it was kind of a fundamentalist church that you didn't show up without a coat and tie. Felt a little bit out of place, even though I was a minister. You know, I'd introduce myself as a pastor, and they looked at me like, you heathen. How dare you not come in uniform? You know?
It sounds rightly.
Thank you, Dave. Exactly right. Yeah. So, at any rate, it was even a concern in a city the size of Lexington, which is down in the Bible Belt. And I think, that, again, for me, the real value of today's lesson is to ask ourselves the question, is there a gradual drifting away within our lives? And if so, what do we need to do to correct it? You know?
Refocus.
We do. And recommit. Recommit. It's, I know, I tell people, I'm old school. I was raised on a diet of Sunday school, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. You know, it's just part of my fabric. I tell people, I'm the first person to say this. My mom took me to church 9 months before I came into the world. I mean, that's how dedicated we were. And, I think that if you look back, most of these churches around, they used to be thriving. What's their condition now? And we talk about this all the time. The only people that can change it are us. And we ask ourselves the question, is there a real need within America to return to God? I'm absolutely convinced that there is. You know, when I see the sort of insanity that is sweeping across our land, you know, the church, I feel like, has the answer. Jesus is the answer, always the answer to everything. But if we don't return to God, I'm fearful at God's judgment. I'll be saying more about that with the morning message this morning. But anyway.
Don't you think, though, it's human nature?
It is.
Because the Israelites, the reason they went into exile in Egypt was because they had drifted away. They were not being obedient. And while they were going through all the wilderness, they was up and down all the time, either good or bad. Mm-hmm. And it goes all the way back, mm-hmm. you know, back to Adam and Eve.
It is human nature. And I know that this is kind of a carryover from last week's message, but our sinful nature, and the Bible talks about this, that we do have two natures if we're born again. We've got a spiritual nature that wants to please God, and then we've got a sinful nature that just wants to please ourselves. Pleasing ourselves is what gets us in trouble.
Yeah.
Doing what we want.
Well, that's, a friend of mine used to say there, within you there are two wolves. And like you said, one's trying to please God, the other is trying to please the sinful nature. And it really comes down to which one do you want to feed?
Amen. And the one that gets fed is the one that wins.
Yeah.
It's the strongest. Absolutely. So we'll just kind of keep that in the back of our mind as we go through today's lesson. This has always been my criticism of lessons in general. This has nothing to do with the writers of the lesson. But oftentimes we as people, we study this as history and we fail to make application to our lives. The real value of studying history is to apply it to our lives and ask ourselves the question, what do I need to learn from their mistakes? And quite honestly, Asa was trying to get things straightened out. Sadly, as I said, and it's not included in our lesson today, and I looked for next week, and now we're going to move to Elijah next week. Not that there's anything wrong with Elijah, but it's just a sad note on Asa's life that at the end of his life, rather than seeking God with a foot disease, Scripture makes very clear mention that he did not. And he suffered.
We had a Bible study one time where it was really about finishing strong. Because if you look at the history of the Bible and some of the greats in the Bible, they all started out well with the Lord, but then they drifted. And it's about finishing firmly, you know, finishing rightly, being right with God when you pass this earth. And unfortunately, a lot of people that were mentioned in the Bible, they started out strong and they didn't finish strong. And that's the big threat to us. I mean, you might be hot for the Lord right now, as hot as you're ever going to be. But if you kind of slowly separate yourself, you're going to get colder and colder.
Amen.
So.
Amen. Well, let's get into the actual lesson itself. And we've got, again, three texts today. Some of them pretty long, like the first one. Do we have a volunteer to read the first one? Dave, you want to read it for us out loud? Thank you.
Wholehearted. In the 20th year of Israel's king Jeroboam, Asa became king of Judah, and he reigned 41 years in Jerusalem. His grandmother's name was Maacah, daughter of Abishalom. Asa did what was right in the Lord's eyes or sight, as his ancestor David had done. He banished the Baal cult prostitutes from the land and removed all of the idols that his ancestors had made. He also removed his grandmother Maacah from being queen mother because she made an obscene image of Asherah. Asa chopped down her obscene image and burned it in the Kidron Valley. The high places were not taken away, but Asa was wholeheartedly devoted to the Lord for his entire life. He brought his father's consecrated gifts and his own consecrated gifts into the Lord's temple, silver, gold, and utensils.
Okay, so it's a great story about Asa. You know, you've got to admire this guy. Have any of you ever bucked family tradition?
I would, but I'd get hit with a cane.
Okay. I'm speaking primarily I'm speaking primarily in religious circles. It's been a little over a year since one of our class members passed away, Mary Conaway. Before she became a Conaway, she was a Sagley. Sagley is Italian. So she was raised Catholic. And there was, you know, when you began to question anything within the Catholic faith, you know, there was just kind of, in some ways, we need to just accept it. And Mary came to the conviction, you know, toward the end of her life, she says, you know, I feel like that I need to be baptized. She didn't want to rest on what had taken place whenever she was an infant. And so I took and baptized her. But I'm only mentioning it because that took courage to buck tradition, family tradition, if you're raised. And so you can imagine Asa, Scotty's grandma, and she has this thing that she worships, a shear pole. It calls an obscene, I think, that in one of my previous lessons, and I don't know, sometime within the past year, I thought that I had read or heard somewhere that they were actually made in the image of something obscene. But I did further reading, and I couldn't find wherever it was that I read it or heard it or whatnot, so I'm not sure about that. But it does mention twice in this passage of Scripture that it was obscene.
It was a fertility god.
Yeah. So.
And it has sexual implications, I believe. That's just me thinking.
And sadly, we've lost sight of even what's obscene within our culture these days. I'm aghast anymore at what I see advertised and the language that is used. But Asa was somebody that was willing to challenge, you know, even his basic family upbringing. And I was just kind of curious if anybody here, Mary's not here to share with us her story of what it involved when she began to question things that she had heard. I will say this, some people might have within their house, a special picture that they almost worship. They might have jewelry around their neck that they almost worship. And the Scripture is very clear. I don't feel like that we make it an object of worship, but I want to say this. We even need to be careful about the cross inside the church. Because what did God say in the Ten Commandments? Don't make anything that you're going to worship. No graven images. And even though the cross represents something, the Bible wants us to recognize that God is spirit, and we need to recognize that we only need to worship Him. But Asa was somebody that you've got to take, give the guy credit that he was willing to go up against his grandmother. He didn't just tell her, "Grandma, you're wrong." I can just imagine as he took an axe to that thing, that shear pole, and chopped it down. It kind of reminds me of the Old Testament story of Gideon. You remember that when Gideon got called into the Lord's service, that he took the yoke from off the oxen, and he built an altar to the Lord, and he also went to the town and he cut down the I don't know if it was a shear or bale or whatnot, but there was a religious object there, and the people woke up the next morning and say, "Who did this?" And they said it was Gideon. And you got to admire Asa because he says, you know what, there is nothing sacred if it doesn't have to do with God.
Yeah.
And I just ask as a question, are there those things that sometimes I maybe shouldn't bring it up, but I've heard people talk about that they carry a lucky coin in their pocket, or they have a special, you know, statue at their house or a picture on the wall or whatnot, and we just need to be very careful about things like that, that they don't become objects of worship, because only God is worthy of our worship. And then if you decide that, well, yeah, I've got one of those in my life, do you dare remove it? And that's what Asa did. He says, I don't care what the ramifications are for me doing this. I need to take a bold stand here. And he did take a bold stand. I'm sorry that the scripture doesn't record what his grandmother said to him.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that it wasn't just the grandmother, because I will tell you this much. When you offend one family member, it doesn't take long for the other family members to start harping in. Am I right? Mm-hmm. And Asa says, you know, I really need to start taking some inventory of what's going on. And I need to address this stuff. You know, that's the key thing in all of these lessons that we do. It's one thing to sit and learn in a classroom. It's another thing to be a doer of the word, as James talks about. Because James says, don't be just hearers of the word and so deceive yourselves, but be ye doers of the word. It says, for if any be a hearer, he's like a man that beholds his face in a natural glass, sees what he looks like, straightway goes about his business and forgets what manner of man he was. The reason that we go through lessons is to not just educate us, but to change us, to get us to act on those things. And I commend Asa. It does say that he reigned 41 years in Jerusalem. And it was the 20th year of King Jeroboam's reign. Jeroboam only was the king of the northern tribe for 21 or 22 years. So
22 years.
It was almost at the very end of Jeroboam's reign. But when Asa became the king of Judah, he says, you know, we need to start looking at why things are the way that they are. And if they're not pleasing in God's sight, let's get to work and change them. And I would just kind of make that appeal to us, that if we don't like the way that things are, let's change it. My great fear, I know that I've mentioned before about the Sunday night and the Wednesday night services. My great fear is that we are becoming a society in which churches will do less and less. And as more of them do less and less, they're going to close. I remember back around 1995, our family made a vacation trip up to Canada. It was only 5 or 6 hours away where we went. But when it came Sunday, we had to drive miles and miles and miles to find a church anywhere. Now granted, Canada was not steeped in religion like we've been steeped down here. But I've oftentimes thought, is that what's going to happen to America? That we're going to have to drive for miles and miles and miles to find churches anywhere. Back to the story about Joe Morris. He would drive over here on Sunday nights because he says, there weren't any other churches. Of course, he liked coming here. But we may need to ask ourselves the question, is this the direction that we feel like it needs to go? And if it's not, change it. And realize that it comes at a cost. For Asa, it was a cost. You know, he received criticism. I'm sure that everybody had to stand around and say, you go, son. Change is not fun. You agree?
People tend to hang on to their past. They get comfortable in a zone, that's where they want to stay. And it's easy to slip into that zone. I mean, you don't do it one giant leap. You make little steps, baby steps.
When I was in seminary, I listened to Chuck Swindoll all the time on the Christian radio station, and one of the messages that he preached, I don't even remember what the entire message was about, but he talked about he was talking about sin, but also was drifting away. He said that it's like the waves coming onto the seashore, and those of us that have been around the ocean. The shoreline does not change overnight, but it's that gradual pull of it that over the years, entire beachfronts can disappear. And he said that that's the way things, it's the little things. Most of us think that it's going to take something big, traumatic within our lives to enact huge changes within our lives. And Chuck Swindoll was trying to warn through the message. It's not going to be those big things. It's going to be the little things. And we start sacrificing here, sacrificing there. And next thing you know, all evidence of those things are gone. They've been removed from our lives. This part of the lesson, it's commending Asa, because Asa decided early on, I'm going to start getting things right. And sadly, he didn't finish well. He did not finish well. But it said that he wholeheartedly devoted to the Lord his entire life.
Yeah, I read that. That's pretty special.
My life's purpose, and just try to get your head around it. My whole purpose for being here is to please God. When I wake up in the morning, God, it's not about what I want to do today. It's about what you want me to do. When it comes to, you know, whether you take things to church, whether you have services or not, I'm impressed in the New Testament, you know, Luke chapter 2, when they took Jesus to the temple to be dedicated, and Anna. It says in one translation, she had been a widow for 84 years, so she could really be a... And then some say that maybe she was just like 84 years of age. It doesn't matter. But it said that that woman did what every day? She went to the temple to pray.
Spent her time in the temple.
Her life was consumed by pleasing God. And so I read this. I'm convicted, Chuck, yeah. When you read about Asa, he dedicated his entire life, devoted his entire life. My whole purpose, Lord, is just to please you.
The thing that I think about in my life, I've said it many times, my mother was orphaned when she was a little girl, and she was raised in a Catholic orphanage. I can remember as a small boy, she made sure I was in Sunday school. Now, she never went to church much, but she made sure that I was in Sunday school.
Amen.
And it was only, I guess, in her later years that she became devoted to the Lord.
And let me say something about the Sunday school. Thank y'all for coming to Sunday school. I really appreciate it.
We come for what you can provide, you and the Lord.
Well, I appreciate that. You know, the Sunday school, there was a time in church life that there wasn't a Sunday school, but there was a man that said, why don't we do a school on Sunday? And it was to provide additional education, more than what you're just going to get in the Sunday morning service. And so they started a Sunday school. As the old saying goes, those who fail to study history are doomed to repeat it. And sadly, we're moving into a culture that really has no biblical knowledge. They really haven't spent a lot of time in the Sunday school,
you know,
to learn what the Bible has to say.
The tragedy of that, Tim, and I mentioned this one day at church. As a 10 instructor, I had to deal with the compulsory education. And in the history of compulsory education, it started with the Puritans. They wanted schools to teach the Bible. And it's come so far from that.
Amen.
I mean, you can't even mention the Lord.
Amen.
In schools. We've allowed it to be stripped away. And it didn't happen overnight. It happened step by step by step.
You're right.
That's how the devil works. He works step by step by step. And we allow it.
Amen.
Because I think it's because when changes happen, they happen so minutely. You don't see it as it's happening. It's only over time that you realize, wait a minute. The last time I saw Tim, his hair was dark. You know, now it's gray. You know, dang that hair, and now he's bald. That kind of thing. Over time, you can notice it, but when it happens so slowly, you fail to recognize what's going on.
Speaking about the hair situation and talking about the waves at the beach. It reminds me, the waves of today are the beaches of tomorrow.
They're bare at the beaches of tomorrow.
No, but you know, you talk about the change, and I was thinking about Chuck being the Sunday school director, and he talked about many times when he was a Sunday school director out there at Creek, Kings Creek.
Kings Creek.
Kings Creek. In the Sunday school campaigns that you used to have, and the high attendance and so on and so forth, and you would run 150 people.
Yeah.
In Sunday school. And now, They're lucky if they can maybe get a dozen for Sunday school.
They're just about closed up.
I know. They have a hard time getting 20 people, 25 people there on a Sunday morning. And so, and you keep emphasizing, it doesn't happen overnight. And that's why I say that's the real value for today's lesson. And I'm preaching to the choir because we're obviously here. But are there other aspects of our Christian life that have begun to suffer? As I told you, I feel I miss very much the Sunday nights. I miss the Wednesday nights. You know, when Wednesday night comes around and it's time for prayer meeting, man, I said, we should be in the house of the Lord praying. We've got enough in this society to pray about these days, don't we? I mean, more than enough. Everywhere you look, you see problems. And I tell you what, we need to humble ourselves and get down on our knees and say, Lord, we need your help. So this first part, it talks about Asa being wholehearted. And I pray that we might begin to develop a wholehearted devotion to God. Yes.
A former NFL football player, Tim Tebow, when he had a time to score a touchdown, he'd get down on his one knee and do his touchdown celebration.
Amen. Amen. And it was a way of honoring God.
And you got criticized.
And the league wants to stop him from doing it. I mean, it just. So that was the first part of today's lesson. Let's move to the second part of what they've included with his life, verses 16 through 19. Who would read this one out loud? Who would like to read this out loud? Sheila, you want to read it? Thank you.
Cornered. There was war between Asa and King Baasha of Israel through their reigns. Israel's king Baasha went to war against Judah. He built Ramah in order to keep anyone from leaving or coming to King Asa of Judah. So Asa withdrew all the silver and gold that remained in the treasuries of the Lord's temple and the treasuries of the royal place and gave it to his servants. Then King Asa sent them to Ben-Hadad, son of Tabrimon, son of Hezion, king of Aram, who lived in Damascus, saying, there is a treaty between me and you, between my father and your father. Look, I have sent you a gift of silver and gold. Go and break your treaty with King Baasha of Israel so that he will withdraw from me.
Now, why did they include this passage of scripture?
Because now he's relying on King.
Relying on the treasures.
Well, he's buying Ben-Hadad with the treasures. Relying on himself. He wants him to attack Israel so that Israel will leave them alone.
If you have your Bibles, you may want to look with me in 2 Chronicles. Well, yeah, we'll get to chapter 16, but chapter 14 first. Chapter 14, 2 Chronicles chapter 14.
What number?
2 Chronicles chapter 14.
Chapter 14.
2 Chronicles 14.
I got it.
It started verse 8. It said, Asa had an army of 300,000 men from Judah, equipped with large shields and with spears, and 280,000 from Benjamin. So that makes a total of 580,000 men, armed with small shields with bows. All these were brave fighting men. Zerah, the Cushite, marched out against them with a vast army and 300 chariots and came as far as Mareshah. Asa went out to meet him. They took up battle positions in the valley of Zephatha near Barisha. I was thinking that it said there that there was 1 million people with him. But that was my understanding that it was. But it said Asa, verse 11, Asa called the Lord his God and said, Lord, there's no one like you to help the powerless against the mighty. Help us, O Lord our God, for we rely on you. And in your name, we have come against this vast army. O Lord, you are our God. Do not let man prevail against us. So I'm just basically getting us to look at that passage of scripture that apparently this happened early on. He depended upon God. Later on,
he's buying help.
He's trying to buy help. And worse than just buying help, he buys it from ungodly Israel. He's king in the southern part, Judah. The northern part is Israel.
He's buying it.
And they've had a number of rulers. I mean, this guy that's in charge now, this Baasha, or however you pronounce it, he basically seized the throne. I mean, there were several different leaders that came on, and they were killed and so on and so forth. And this guy is ruthless. But it does not say that Asa, when this threat appeared, that he sought the Lord like he did against the Cushite. When he was against the Cushite, he cried out to the Lord. When he goes up against the king of Israel, he starts asking for help from Aram, which later on is Syria, Damascus, so on and so forth. And he pays them all this money. And so it kind of goes back to what we're talking about, Dave, that how did he start drifting? And I'll ask us the question, have you formulated in your mind, have you drifted at all? Are you as committed now as you once were? And what has contributed to the drifting? You know, do we still, I'll kind of throw this out here, do we still, whenever we get physical problems, come to the church as our first source of help and get down on our knees and say, Lord, I've got medical problems? Or do we run to the physicians? You know, I was going to go to 2 Chronicles chapter 16. I know that our time is running out. But it says in 2 Chronicles chapter 16, the events of Asa reign, beginning and end, are written in the book of the kings of Judah and Israel. That's the 11th verse, chapter 16. In the 39th year of his reign, and he reigned for 41 years. But in the 39th year of his reign, Asa was afflicted with a disease in his feet. Though his disease was severe, even in his illness, he did not seek help from the Lord, but only from the physicians. This is in the 39th year. He started out seeking the Lord with all of his heart. At the end of his life, when he's got disease in his feet, he doesn't even seek the Lord. He starts going to the doctors. And pardon me, but whenever people are diagnosed with severe illnesses, do they make their way to the house of the Lord and come before the altar and cry out before? And I'm not saying that you can't do that at home, but I'm just asking, has that contributed to the decline of the church? I think it's a valid question that we really need. You may find it interesting if you go up to the 7th verse, and this has to do with the invading army. You go up to the 7th verse of chapter 16. At that time, Hanani, the seer, came to Asa, king of Judah, and said to him, because you relied on the king of Aram, and this is a condemnation for having hired the king of Aram to help him out with King Baasha, because you relied on the king of Aram and not on the Lord your God, the army of the king of Aram has escaped from your hand. Were not the Cushites and the Libyans a mighty army with great numbers of chariots and horsemen? Yet when you relied on the Lord, he delivered them into your hand. For the eyes of the Lord range throughout the earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed in him. You have done a foolish thing, and from now on, you'll be at war. Asa was angry with the seer because of this. He was so enraged that he put this man of God, this prophet, put this prophet in prison. And at the same time, Asa brutally oppressed some of the people. When you're out of fellowship with God, you're going to take it out on others. It's kind of a sad testimony to Asa. You know, he started out so good, but he drifted. And I think that it bears us always ask the question, not just now, but as we go through life, Are we drifting further and further away from the Lord? Or are we getting stronger in our commitment to Him? And if we're not getting stronger, what do we need to do to get stronger? Are there some things that I need to change within my life? And I would just encourage us, do whatever is necessary to keep that relationship with God the strongest in your life, because ultimately, your eternal destiny rests in His hands. We got one more passage of Scripture. I know our time is almost up. Do you have any questions or comments that you'd like to make? Well, let's look at the last passage of Scripture. Crowbar, do you want to read the last passage of Scripture?
Some of the words that probably won't be able to pronounce.
And I tell you what, you can just use the first initial.
Ben-Hadad listened to King Asa and sent the commanders of his armies against the cities of Israel. He attacked Ajon, Dan, Abel Beth, Makkah. Oh boy, all Kinnereth and the whole land of Naphtali.
You're good.
Let me just make my corrections.
You're fine.
Baasha heard about it. He quit building Ramah and stayed in Tirzah. Then King Asa gave a command to everyone without exception in Judah, and they carried away the stones of Ramah and the timbers Baasha had built it with. Then King Asa built Gibeah of Benjamin and Mizpah with him. I hope you can understand all the cities.
I did. You did a great job.
Yes.
And I noticed that you still had Linda programmed for autocorrect. So, just kidding. You know, this is what I was trying to say. It's a shame that they didn't tell us the other parts of Asa's life. You know, when Asa, Aram did come, and they fought King Baasha, who was Israel, and basically what happened, I won't go into that. They defeated Israel. Israel kind of pulled back and stopped giving Judah a problem. But here's the problem that they really didn't spend much time bringing out. What did Asa teach all the people in his kingdom by turning to godless Aram for assistance? Did you teach the people in Judah to seek God first and foremost? Or did you, by your actions, teach the people within your kingdom, do whatever's necessary, even if you have to leave God out? By the way, Aram did, as we read about Hanani the seer, Aram did. Those were the Arameans. They continued to give problems. Rather than judging these people as unfit to be helping us, it would be like us, rather than asking God to help us, let's go get Russia or let's get China to help us out. You know what a servant of God would say? We don't need help that bad. I'm serious. It would be, we need to rely upon the righteousness of God. Okay? So I just want to add to the discussion, I know our time is up. You and I need to be careful that our actions are having an influence on others. And are we influencing them to seek the Lord more? Or are we influencing them to seek the Lord less? The sad thing with the situation with Aram is that his actions, I feel like, set a bad example for the entire nation.
Mm-hmm. And we set examples every day.
Every day
there was people watching us.
Exactly.
And quite honestly, I hate to bring up my situation again, but I feel, you know, on Sunday nights and Wednesday nights, people that have known me all my life, those are the Lord's time. I'm not in the house of the Lord. Mm-hmm. And it does bother me. And I'm very grateful for the time to spend with Mom and Dad. I do want us to get back to. And nothing in the Bible tells us that we have to have all of these services. But what I'm afraid we've had happen within our society is that we continue to cut more and more of God out of our lives.
People spent, it's like when I first started It was really hard for me because we always done big family meals on Sundays. That was a big thing. We all were, you know, we took turns. So when I dropped out of that circle, don't think I wasn't judged. It was hard when I started to get firm with my belief, just to come to church. So that was a big step. So I think now what's happening to the churches, and I really believe this, with the sickness we've had, with them closing, people are filling their time with other things.
There's no doubt about it.
And it's going to be hard for them to get back. Because once you break that cycle, it's hard to get back in. It's just hard. And a lot of people won't do the sacrifice and get back into church.
I agree with you wholeheartedly. And we've made a lot of things easy with, you know, online stuff. And I'm not against the online stuff. But I tell you what, I don't want to see these buildings close their doors. I know that it's a building, but I tell you what, it represents God's standards within our communities. And quite honestly, I feel like that everywhere you look, you're seeing churches that are on the verge of closing their doors. And the only people that can change it are the people of God. The world isn't going to change it. I wish that we could get back to having high attendance in Sunday school. I wish that Christians would say, you know what, I need to come to Sunday school so that I can learn more of the Bible. You know, and teach, you know, our family members, this is a wonderful place in order to come and learn. And I was reminded this past week that my job as a minister isn't to do the ministry, it's to train the work minister. I don't have to be the teacher every week. I mean, we need to start other classes. I'm very grateful that Janet here a couple, 3 weeks ago when we had some kids out front, she says, you know what? I want to take those kids and start teaching them. So she did. And she started working, you know.
That's religion in this country. Is that if you look at churches, by and large, they're gray. Except for people like me that don't have
gray and white.
Yeah, and what happens is I've seen so many churches that have shut their doors that used to be churches that are now bars, you know. There's one in Power that I saw. The church down in Wheeling, you know, people didn't go. Someone created a fire, and now that building's gone. You know, it's that church is gone. And a friend of mine used to go there. She religiously, from the time she was a child to an adult. And when that church burned, they didn't replace it. And the Catholic church has just, it's shrunk. You know, they used to be in every community, but that's not the case anymore. And it's because of the same reasons our churches are closed. We're getting gray and no one to replace us. So if we allow that to happen, the ember's going to go out. The fire's going out.
It is. So it's a good lesson about Asa. You know, that he started out well, but he didn't finish well. And he drifted away. And it's a reminder to us, be on your guard. You don't think it can happen to you, it can happen. You've got to maintain the fire and do self-evaluation. So let's have a closing prayer. Father, we are grateful that as we go through the Bible, we can read stories about people like Asa. We're thankful that we've got that story recorded. And we pray that we will try to be like he was at the beginning of his service to you, that he really loved you. But then as he got older, He wavered in that commitment. And pray, Father, that we won't allow that to happen. That you will help us to identify those things that may be pulling us away from you. And that we'll rekindle the fire. And recognize that with you, all things are possible. That you can take care of all our needs as we commit ourselves to you. So please help us, Father, to learn from Asa. And to make sure that we stay devoted to you for our entire lives. We thank you for the lesson, and we pray that you'll bless it to make changes in our lives if necessary, that we might honor you. And we request now a service to follow. Use it for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.